So Lord Diltari has a subscribe star also known as the Paladin. I would really recommend anyone who's invested in this story to go over and check it out. It's a solid way to help support the author and help get stories like this written. So check out the top link in the description. Though let's start, will we? Be me, Paladin, wanted in three different planes of existence for creating plots to place the world in grave danger so my players can be heroic and all that. Be the Paladins of Order Undivided and recently Fireballed, Kazdor the only mildly annoyed, Peregrine the agile, Andri the slightly singed, Yort the not standing nearby, Julian the toasty, and Senkit the unscathed. As the flames clear and the Paladins adjust their eyes after the blinding flare, they see dark shapes rush from the firelight towards them. As they come into the light, the shapes are shown to be gigantic lizards covered in red scales, about the size of a large wolf, snarling not quite like anything they've ever heard before, save Senkit, to whom they sound vaguely like an annoyed meager raptor. The drakes leap into the kobold camp, attacking everything that comes in reach. Around the camp, several other kobolds shimmer out of disguises, revealing their scarlet hides and striking at the others around them. Several manifesting the same glowing stigmata as the mage who led the attack. The Paladins whirl in the confusion, uncertain where the enemy is or where to attack, but Senkit takes command. Kaz, Julian, the lizards on the left and right flank. Peregrine, Yort, the infiltrators. Andri, support me. I'll deal with the mage. Protect the kobolds. Order on me. She orders the party and charges the mage. The kobold warlock watches her approach and raises his hand, a curved sword forged of shimmering scarlet energy forms in it and blocks the first attack. Senkit lunges low and bashes the kobold, sending him sliding back a few inches but not felling him. She strikes again and this time nails the warlock across the face, but he turns back, unnaturally strong. Andri draws back her bow and fires into the melee, hitting the warlock in the thigh and the shoulder. He steps back, testing the weight on his leg. Back in the scattered melee of the camp, Yort slips into the chaos and re-emerges with his borrowed spear in an infiltrator's back. The rogue whirls in a flurry of lunging daggers, but Yort's training against Peregrine has left him more than prepared. Leaning into the attack, he parries the onslaught aside and impales the small assassin on his spear. Peregrine steps between another two assassins and their prey, a pair of fairly young kobolds, one already wounded trying to fight back. He blocks their knives, each sword working independently to stop two others from two different opponents. On his left he stops an overhead swipe dead, slaps down an underhand thrust, and then slashes the assassin's belly open. On his right he flicks his sword back and forth to parry both sides of a pincer attack, then slashes apart the assassin's knee. The assassin stumbles, and Peregrine brings in his left-hand sword to drive it into the kobold's throat from an unexpected angle. Julian takes to the skies to fly over the chaotic encampment and reach the first drake quickly. He falls like lightning with the vengeful sprit raised aloft and brings the drake to its knees with the mighty blow. Astoundingly, despite the tremendous impact and the supernatural edge of his sword, he cannot cut through the beast's scales. He pulls back as the adamantine-scaled monstrosity turns and lunges for him, just as planned. As the drake leaps, he lunges, using the point of his sword like a spear to slip between the tough scales and score a telling blow. Julian roars as he steps forwards and channels his power, flinging the drake back and into a campfire, the explosive force ripping away sections of its armor. But the drake just gets up, unfazed by the flames of Julian or the campfire. Kazdor is having similar problems, astounded that the creature's scales can deflect his axes. He shifts his grip upwards to strike with even more savage force. He hears bones crack under the skin, but still can't get through the armor. Changing tack, he instead drops his other axe and grabs the drake by the throat and lifts it off the ground, strangling it. The monster hisses weakly and claws at him with its talons, but they are as ineffective against Kazdor's mail as his axes are against its hide. As Senkit and the warlock clash back and forth, a physical body trained to perfection against ensorcelled strength, the kobold activates another stigmata, which gleams crimson. Then he vanishes from sight. Senkit looks for footprints or other telltale signs of where an invisible creature went, but the kobold didn't go invisible. No, instead it teleported above her, and while Andri shouts a warning, it's too late. The tiny warlock falls from above and drives his hicks blade into Senkit's shoulder, where the armor meets the neck. Dark power surges as an eldritch smite drives the paladin to her knees in a twisted mockery of her own power. Andri raises her bow and touches her finger to the arrow. Swift death to those who oppose me. She hisses, and the arrow glows with divine power. Loosed, it flies true into the warlock's side, and then explodes with a surge of power, throwing him off the tiefling. Peregrine turns to see the sound, but is thrown down as a crackle of lightning strikes him from behind. Another warlock approaches, Hick's blade raised and electricity flying from his fingertips into the halfling like a dark emperor out of ancient legend. Peregrine grits his teeth through the pain and stands up, using his swords to absorb the electricity, the bone hilts unable to channel it into him. He steps forwards and cuts off the warlock's fingers, ending the spell. The kobold retaliates with a downward cut, but Peregrine not only stops the blade, but rolls his sword around it and severs the warlock's hand at the wrist. Blood fountains from the wound, and Peregrine goes for the kill, but the kobold manifests the blade again from his stump and manages to knock aside the lunge for his heart, panting heavily. Back with Julian, he readies himself as the drake leaps from the flames at him. He takes a scratch on the shoulder from its talons but manages to sweep aside its fangs from his throat. Seeing a vulnerability where he struck it earlier, he takes his left hand off his sword and plunges it like a talon into the drake's innards. Hot blood burns his hands as he breaks through ribs and grabs hold of some organ or another. Then with a surge of power blasts his arm out in a visceral attack that leaves the beast's chest a ruined crater. Kazdor likewise takes a scratch across his face, three lines scoring it from eyeball to jawbone. Despite this, he powers through, seizing the monster's head in both hands, and with a straining of his mighty arms, he snaps the drake's neck, dropping it. As he raises a hand to his face to heal it, he sees several more of the scarlet kobolds slinking out of the camp and away from the battlefield, with sacks on their backs filled with something brown. He turns and sees nearly a dozen dead around where the eggs were being kept. The eggs. The schooners are taking the eggs. This whole bloody mess was a diversion. He shouts in warning and sprints after the kidnappers, who redouble their speed. Senkit hears the warning and moves to her feet, ignoring the fallen warlock as she and Undri race for Kaz and the abductors. Undri does take the time to turn and fire another blessed arrow into the warlock as he gets up, nailing him to a tree and wrapping him in spider silk silver vines. Peregrine hears the cry and his eyes go deadly, the killer's glint igniting as he goes back in against the warlock to finish him off. Defense forsaken as he brings the occult kobold to his knees in a series of thrusts and slashes too fast for the eye to follow. As he goes in for the kill though, the warlock demonstrates surprising tenacity, lunging forwards and grabbing him about the waist as another stigmata glows and magical energy begins to build. Peregrine struggles to get free from the suicide bomber's death grip, before dropping his swords and grabbing the warlock by the face. Black vines erupt from the kobold's eyes and nose as Peregrine channels enough necrotic energy to wither the flesh from his bowels and leave the kobold's head a grinning skull. Pushing the corpse off him, he grabs his blades and runs for the kidnappers. Kazdor is hot on the heels of the retreating kobolds, almost catching up. He is so focused on stopping them that he forgets the first rule of fighting kobolds. They are always traps, although this one is a bit unusual. As Kazdor nearly reaches the slowest kobold, his combat sense warns him of some imminent threat, as he steps on something that clinks under his boot. Clinks like a chain. The chitin emerges from the shadows as the chains it scattered across the retreat path animate and wrap around the dragonborn, before flinging him through a tree in a shower of splinters. As Kazdor gets to his feet and raises his axes to attack, a second set of chains wrap around one of his arms and yanks it back. Kazdor strains as the two devils quite literally try to rip him limb from limb, able to hold his ground, but not anymore. As he watches the kobolds escape with the stone and children, he turns to the chitons, and swears to them. There is no hell that will stop me from saving those children. Kazdor drops one of his axes, balls his claw into a fist, and rips his left arm out of the chains. The force rips most of the scales from his arm and leaves it a mess of bloody rents and exposed muscle tissue, but it still works. He turns and grabs the other chain holding him and turns like an Olympic hammer thrower. The devil goes flying, crashing in front of the kidnappers with a thud as Kazdor unleashes his wings and soars for them, axe in one hand and hammer in the other. Undri arrives shortly before Senkit, seeing the situation she draws back her bow, taking careful aim to not hit the bags, and nails one of the kobolds in the back of the head with two arrows. Senkit arrives shortly thereafter, smelling something familiar as she recognizes the chain devils for what they are and moves to counter the one Kaz didn't turn into a missile. She ducks under the whirling chains, deflecting them off her shield even as they wrap around it. Exactly what she wanted. The brimstone dragoness stops dead in her tracks and pushes down on her shield, then steps on the chains. The chitin is dragged down with their chains and raises an arm to protect its face as Senkit lays into it with her morning star.
Go!
Help Kaz! She orders Undri. Undri obeys as she follows the enraged dragonborn and continues to fire on the kidnappers. Even at this extreme range her sharp eyes can place her shots accurately and another kobold drops. The chained devil Senkit has pinned down Twist to get free, and then its eyes go wide in genuine fear as it rolls away from Julian and his blazing sword. It looks at the blade with worry and looks at Senkit. "Do you have any idea what that thing is?" it asks her in Infernal. "A sword that destroys evil," Senkit says calmly, and the devil laughs. "Evil? Child, that weapon will kill everything it can. You have no idea what you're dealing with. So it's an effective weapon," Julian answers in perfect Infernal before swiping again at the chitin and sending it sprawling with the burning wound in its chest. "Though I must admit you've piqued my curiosity. Not bad for a liar." Peregrim's feet pound the path towards the battle past the bound warlock when an explosion throws him and the Ort from their feet. The kobold leader steps out of the crater where the tree he was bound to just was, Hick's blade still glowing. The halfling and the hobgoblin turn and prepare to put this threat down for good. The warlock charges into the pair with the fury of a man who knows he is already dead. The hellblade strikes and chops with diabolical fury at both, forcing Peregrine a step back and striking the head off of Yort's spear. Yort steps back and vanishes from sight, while Peregrine retaliates, slashing open the warlock's eyebrow, forearm, and chest. The warlock just laughs and casts his free hand out. His own blood forms into daggers and stabs into Peregrine, staggering the small paladin. He steps forwards to attack again when he is knocked aside by Yort, who comes back into being swinging the spear shaft like a staff and sending the kobold sprawling. The warlock gets up and puts a hand to his head. "Just a scratch," he taunts. "A scratch is all I need," Yort responds coolly and snaps his fingers. The warlock seizes up and foams at the mouth, grasping at his chest as the assassin's poison shuts down every organ in his body and drops him. Kazdor and his wings hit the back of the kobold line like a remarkably gentle freight train, blistering rage refined to a razor's edge as he tears the kidnappers apart, but makes very carefully sure to avoid damaging the bags full of eggs. Even restrained, he is sublimely effective and reduces the kobolds to a single individual who dives into a burrow. Kaz dives for the tunnel entrance, but the chitin has other ideas. A chain punches a hole through Kaz's wings and wraps around them, crushing them at Act 20. Kazdor and the wings howl in pain as they revert to the scaled cloak and drop him to the ground. Kaz stands up, breathing hard, but grits his teeth and turns to face the devil. "Your resolve is remarkable. The pain from that experience would have killed most, and put almost any other entity into shock." The devil compliments him. "You exist within a third standard deviation from the norm, exquisite." "I'm nee done yet," Kaz says, but his stance says otherwise. He's hurt quite badly. "I'll make the fourth and the fifth and whatever comes after and your damned categorizations. And ye can tell all the scumbag in the hells about how Kazdor Glamdring took everything ye had and broke ye right back. Highly improbable. You are at the end of your rope, and should simply surrender so that no further damage comes to you before your inevitable defeat. Ardeni bend the knee, knee before any but my gods and my laird. Come on ye blighter, unless ye need a breather." "No. I've kept you talking long enough," the devil responds with a cruel smile as his chains activate. Having snuck through the tall grass to wrap around Kaz's ankles and lift him into the air before smashing him into the ground repeatedly, the devil turns briefly as an arrow strikes him in the shoulder. He grunts and turns to see Andre moments before she lets another fly at him. He doesn't move, but his chains whirl and interpose 8 feet of scaly cover between him and the bolt. Kazdor wheezes as the arrow hits him in the sternum. Senkit turns as she sees the trouble Kaz is in and tries to get clear from the chitin, taking several blows from the chains as she rushes towards him. The chitin himself takes advantage of the removal of the weight from his chains and uses them to grab Julian in his chains and hold him away. The Arsima struggles for a moment, then grins as Bast appears and leaps onto the devil's face. The devil reaches up and throws the cat away, lashing out with a chain to kill it, but the chain is seared away by a blazing blade. "Don't touch my cat," the scourge warns, and lunges for the chitin. The devil raises its chains to block him off, but Julian leaps over him. In a soaring flip, he flies over the devil and lands on its other side, splitting the chains off of it where they connect to the devil's back. The other chitin sees this, the charging Senkit, and everything else, and decides now would be a good time to go. He looks at the oncoming tiefling and gets a strange feeling he's seen her somewhere before, but now it's not the time for that. He turns to Kazdor, still weakly struggling to get loose, and sighs as he raises his hand and activates his own stigmata. The mark of the burning lord glows brightly, and Kazdor's eyes glaze over as magical slumber takes him. The devil smiles slightly, then retreats into the tunnel, dragging Kazdor down into the dark with him, and collapsing the entrance behind. "Be me, Paladin, constructor of unnecessarily complicated doorknobs. B. The Paladins of Order Undivided -1, Julian the Proud, Senkit the Diligent, Peregrine the Kind, Andre the Patient, and the Ort the Humble. Still reeling in the immediate aftermath of an attack that left a dozen of their kobold allies slain and their friend Kazdor captured by a chain devil. Julian and Senkit watch enraged as the tunnel collapses behind the Khitan, leaving them unable to follow. The surviving Khitan, crippled by Julian, starts to slink away, but Andre sees it and places an arrow through its ankle, pinning it to the ground. Julian hears its scream and approaches, vengeful spirit in hand. He strikes the devil with the flat of the blade and throws it to the ground before placing his boot on its throat. You devils love deals, don't you? He hisses through clenched teeth. Here's my one and only offer. Tell me where your partner is taking Kazdor, and I will send you back to the hells in as relatively painlessly a way as I can manage. Don't, and I start burning pieces off until you talk, and then I destroy you, permanently. The devil opens its mouth to talk, when the stigmata on its hand flares into light again, burning red into the night. It speaks, but not with its own voice, but a deep, reptilian rasp, very much like Kazdor's, except like it's coming from a mountain. The dragonborn is mine, son of Celestia, and I part not with my property lightly. The burning lord speaks through his servant's tongue. You shall also be added to my collection, as will the elf. The halfling and devil will prove interesting bargaining chips, and the kobolds shall be slaughtered for their heresy against me. I shall occupy the abbey and rule over all of these lands. You royally suck at negotiation, or intimidation, whatever it is you're trying to do. Andre says, crossing her arms. I am not negotiating. Merely informing you of the inevitable future that you might have time to prepare yourselves. Out of respect for your abilities and your service to me in destroying Cluny, I grant you this mercy. You haven't taken the abbey, or as yet. Senkit tells the voice. No. But I have determined that this is the outcome I desire, and what I desire I shall procure. Your skills and weapons are insufficient to defeat me. I have observed this as even that fearsome sword of yours is unable to pierce the creatures I gave life from my detritus. You will come for your friend, and I shall crush you. For this is my will. We shall see. Julian says coldly, before driving vengeful spirit into the devil's face, killing it and breaking the connection. The paladins regroup, heal up, and evaluate the situation. 14 kobolds are dead, almost all the eggs have been recovered intact and the supplies are still in fairly decent shape. They're still a week from the abbey and Kazdor is being dragged further and further away by the moment. Tensions are running high. You heard what he said. He's after us and it's only a matter of time before there's another attack and more deaths. Senkit shouts at Julian as they discuss. We should be getting Kaz back and bringing this foe down. He also said he was going to wipe out the kobolds, and he was going to attack the abbey. If he decides to deal with that before us while we're separated, then they'll be defenseless. We don't have a clue what he is or what he's capable of. We can't just rush in. Julian counters. His voice is calm and icy cold, his face a calm mask, but clearly a mask. We have no choice but to rush in unless you plan on leaving Kaz to die. Senkit responds, getting up close in Julian's face. The Arsima snaps and hits her in the chest, not dealing any damage, but throwing her back across the meeting ground. Senkit goes for her mace and Julian his sword before Andre and the Ort Beisically hold them both back. Enough. Peregrine commands them, Hazel eyes dangerously sharp. He does not raise his voice, but that almost makes it worse. We are not leaving Kazdor to die. Nor are we going to rush in without a plan. Neither will we allow worry to drive us to such behaviors as this. Sit down. Even the stubborn Tifling and the rebellious Arsima stop, though they keep glaring daggers at one another. They sit, and Peregrine pours everyone some tea. Nobody touches it. It is obviously imperative that we both direct the kobolds back to Hearthfire and assemble its defenses. We must also pursue Kazdor before the trail goes cold. As these two tasks require us to be in two places at once, it seems we must divide our forces. I'll lead them back and hold down the fort. Yort says, and the others turn to him. I'm the only one here with command experience in a siege and the best suited to getting the kobolds to coordinate if we're attacked again. You do realize if you're attacked you'll be all on your own. Andre cautions him. Acceptable. I might not be as good a fighter as the rest of you, but I can hold off an attack long enough for the kobolds to get away. Hells with my invisibility, I might even survive it. You're going to need as much firepower as possible if you're going to get back Kaz, and I'm the weakest one here. Yort admits. So be it. Peregrine says with a grim nod. Now, we need a way to track their movements, the tunnel probably isn't that long, so if we can find the other exit we can track them from there. I can help with that. Yorick says. The paladins aren't exactly keeping a private conference, more akin to talking in a circle around a campfire with a whistling teapot in the middle, surrounded by kobolds. And I say akin in the way that someone might be akin to themselves. Tunnels, especially one like for Big Devil, take up space, disrupt ground above, can track it if know what doing. Urike explains. Right. There's a plan then. Gather supplies, report to the matriarch, and get ready, we move out in less than an hour. Peregrine orders, and they jump to it. In less than half an hour, they are ready to go, and set out, following Urike as he in turn follows the trail. It's slow going though, and the tunnel goes on far longer than expected. It isn't until after the sun has risen, past its zenith, and begun to set again that they find the exit to the tunnel. This not possible to dig this quickly. Urike says, looking over it tiredly. They cheated. He pouts, wavering unsteadily on his feet. The party aren't doing that well either. They all are quite groggy and have pounding headaches from exhaustion. The slow, tedious work of finding and tracking the tunnel has worn on them a great deal. Even their mounts look tired. Right. Undri. Tracks, Senkit says, still forcing herself to stand up despite her exhaustion. Undri shakes her head though. New moon, not enough, enough, she snaps her fingers three times. Light. Yes, not enough light to track by. Sleep, or trance deprivation as it is, has taken its toll on her ability to produce coherent thoughts. Wait, wait, Peregrine says before he begins to yawn. The adrenaline is run out, and now all that is left is tired and scared and stressed. Right, I can make light. Julian says as he holds up a flickering orb of indigo. It looks like a light bulb on its last legs and about to go out. Right. Tracks. Undri says, bending to look. Her vision is blurry. She sees the tracks but they don't make any sense. The grass looks very comfortable though. Her vision blurs, and she drifts off into trance unintentionally in a kneeling position. Shit. Julian. Magic? Senkit asks wearily. Julian shakes his head. Barely holding light up. Shouldn't be this tired already. Hungry too. Stress TRAAANZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZZ Grin, who is also already collapsed, curled up into a ball. She looks around and finds it very strange. Andre said it was dark, but what lights? Senkit looks befuddled at the swirling fairy green lights all around her, like fireflies but brighter, and all leaving trails of sparkling dust. The tiny fae chuckle softly to themselves, whisking around to drape blankets of pine needles over the sleeping party, stopping briefly only to whisk away a few shiny baubles here and there from Julian's components that they fancy. The fairies aren't malicious, in fact they're exceedingly smug and self-satisfied that their pranks actually helped someone for once. Well, help them from their point of view. Keep going that way and you'll run into the chain monster and the very loud fire-breathing thing it's carrying with it. The party awakens later, finding themselves wrapped in the fairy blankets and with food and drink set out before them. Fortunately, none of them are foolish enough to eat fae food, and so they distribute jerky and apples so they can eat on the road. Andre finds the devil's trail remarkably easily. A huge bald monster wrapped in chains carrying a 500-pound dragonborn is hardly stealthy even when they want to be. The trail leads southwards and east, away from the coast and back towards the mountains. The party moves as fast as they can while keeping up the trail, stopping neither to rest nor to eat. Even Peregrine doesn't raise a complaint as they keep going past lunch, past tea, and past dinner without break. They pass through a long dominion of the Seelie Fae, watched by many a cloaked fairy and hidden satyr. The merry folk look on curiously, but with the coming of the devil and the grim air around the party, none are quite courageous or foolish enough to waylay them with a prank or an unbirthday party or anything so ridiculous. As the sun begins to set, the party hears a change in the woods. They become quieter, the fair folk long vanished even from corners of eyes and sideways glances. First that, then the sound of animals cease almost to a whisper. Then the birds stop singing. Then it is deadly quiet. Until they summit one last hill and look down from the deathly still border into the dominion of the Burning Lord. A scorched veil spanning from a mountain in the south across every foothill in a dozen miles. Every tree has been burnt to the ground, which is white like winter's snow with ash. Nothing lives, nothing walks the barren land. There is no real solid border to destruction, no apparent pattern or point. It is as though a child took a magnifying glass that spanned the firmament and burnt the earth like an ant or spider, just to watch it burn. or perhaps as though a particularly angsty teenager got their hands on approximately one Apocalypse Now worth of napalm and decided to rebel against existence itself while listening to a lot. And I mean a lot of Linkin Park. Kazdor did in fact regain consciousness once during his journey. Upon doing so, he attempted to blast the devil with fire. When this failed, he proceeded to bitch out the devil with such language that if I repeat it, I'm getting banned from this site and put on several different lists. Fortunately for Kazdor, the Tsar are not monitoring him, not that they'd need to wiretap him. His tirade is sufficiently loud to shake the trees, cause ripples in streams and ponds 40 feet away, and make a devil accustomed to the constant screams of the damned annoyed enough that the chitin simply strangles him unconscious and does not permit him to regain consciousness until they arrive. When Kaz finally does regain consciousness, he does so with a pounding headache and generally shitty outlook on life due to repeated strangulation, blunt force trauma, losing most of the skin on one of his arms, and worst of all, alcohol withdrawal. The room he is pitch dark, and he's hanging upside down, still wrapped in chains. He can't tell where he is, where the floor is, where the ceiling is, or where the walls are. What he can tell is that he's not alone, there's another being in the room, one with an incredibly powerful presence. The room is hot, but not so much as to be uncomfortable for the flamborn paladin, and there are distinct smells. The solid tinge of hard rock, probably granite, and in similar measure the distinct metallic scent of precious metals, gold, silver, platinum even. There is also the distinct reek of brimstone, strongest around the chains. Worst though is a smell that sets Kaz's reptile brain spinning. It is a strong, heavy, sooty smell, like the smoke from a wood-burning fire, but bears with it an animal musk. Kaz has a very bad feeling about what exactly he's been caught by. "Greetings, Kazdor Glaimdring, welcome to my lair," the Burning Lord speaks, in perfect Draconic. "If welcome to you means being strung up like a slab of meat and not offered a drink and deceit, then I have some strong words for whoever raised you," Kazdor remarks back. The Burning Lord chuckles and Kazdor drops, landing with a clatter and clink on a pile of gold. Kaz gets to his feet, his weapons are gone, but he still has his armor. The pile of valuables he's landed in just adds another fact to the list, which is pointing towards a seriously worrying conclusion. "Ah yes, where are my manners? I am afraid I was not as educated in the fineries of Dwarven etiquette as you were, little cousin," the Lord says with a tone that says he's smirking ear to ear. "Dwarven has nothing to do with it, unless you're a bat. Keeping your guests upright is just common sense, as is inviting them with a letter or a messenger, not a beating," Kaz says, still looking around, trying to figure out where exactly the voice is coming from. "Common sense is for lesser beings," the voice chuckles arrogantly. "The Dan service. So what, you've dragged me here to organize your gold hoard or fight for you? You know my name, but if you knew a damn thing about me, you know you should have saved the time and killed me," Kazdor responds defiantly. "Well, yes and no. I don't really expect you to do anything, except give me some interesting data and possibly die in an amusing manner. You're the closest thing this land has had to a proper life form in a few centuries, and testing needs be done. That and to draw the rest of the lab rats some toys after you." "You mean my friends? Ha, you're going to regret that. An angel's son to feed to the hells, a halfling to give to the fae, an elven maid for my plaything, oh, and the devil." The Burning Lord laughs, long, hard, and cruelly. "Oh, she will be most entertaining and useful on top of that." Kazdor blazes with rage, glowing bright red in the dark, so hot is his fury that his mouth foams and the foam turns to steam, the golden hoard he stands upon begins to melt and bluggle. Still in his flask, begins to uncomfortably bubble. The Burning Lord laughs all the harder for it, taking sadistic pleasure from riling the dragonborn up. What magnificent rage. No wonder Clunny never stood a chance. "Of all the insects I have encountered, you burn brighter than any," he cackles, delighted to see it. "It is truly impressive, for a pathetic imitation." "Ah, me imitating anything?" Kazdor snarls, his blue eyes violet with blood wrath. "Come out of the dark, and I'll show you just how got this really burns." "Interesting. Very well, I will come out," the Burning Lord says, and the cavern is lit in scarlet, as the temperature jumps to the interior of a blast furnace. Kazdor shields his eyes from the sudden light, and falls to a knee in the gold as it begins to liquefy around him. His scales smoke and steam, as he looks up at a head as big as he is. Avernius, the Burning Lord stands before him atop his hoard. A massive red dragon, not quite yet into the prime of adulthood, but far larger than any juvenile, glowing brightly with its own internal heat. An imdigoi, the size of Kazdor's head, regards him, like an open cauldron of hellfire. Avernius reaches up with a talon as long as a gladius and lifts Cassus face upwards. The scales and flesh beneath warp, melt, and scar like under a branding iron as the talon forces the paladin's head up. Cass looks at a head and in some distant corner of his mind thinks how he really does look like a dragger. He's quite handsome actually. He is also delirious from the heat. The intense heat given off by Avernius makes the air shimmer around him, as though Cass was looking at the dragon through a pool of water. Water, that would be nice right about now. Cass looks up and sees the dragon's wings. These are cooler, and can be seen clearly. Wings. Wings, wait, where are his wings? The dragon is monologuing again. Cass doesn't particularly care. His eyes droop and roll to the side. His cloak is gone. Bastards stole it. That's another grudge. Were his shoulder scales always that thick? Strange. Strange. Why is it getting dark? Is the dragon dumb showing off? Be me, Paladin, maker of both mountains and molehills. Be the paladins of order temporarily divided. Castor, captured by the powerful Burning Lord, Julian, Senkit, Peregrine, and Undri, the rescue team, and Eort. Leading the kobolds back to the abbey to prepare its defenses. Castor slowly groans awake as he feels something cool and wet on his fevered forehead. He sits up, causing Bluggle to bubble at him discontentedly. He looks around and sees that he's in total darkness. He raises his hand to conjure light and sees he's in a cell, about 8x8, with stone walls and a metal door set into one of them. He sits up, noting he's been left to sit on an elevated stone shelf that serves as sort of a bed. A small trickle of water runs out of the wall and pools in a natural basin. He sniffs it, and it smells perfectly normal. Head pounding from dehydration, he takes a calculated risk and drinks. It tastes normal. The only other water in the room, Bluggle, continues to wrap around him, cooling him off. He feels fevered, but he knows he can't get sick. He looks at the arm he damaged in his fight with the Chain Devil before he was captured. It's almost completely healed, thank the gods for long rests. He looks himself over. His armor is battered but still on him, though his weapons and equipment are gone. Fortunately, they didn't take to take the flask Bluggle was in, so he still has the water elemental. He looks again to where his cloak of scales should be resting, but it's not there. Strange, he still feels the weight of it on his shoulders, and his pauldrons seem to be riding a bit higher. He also feels a strange feeling on his back, right to the left and right of his spine. Feeling suspicious, he unbuckles his armor and looks again. Sure enough, the scales on his back and shoulders have grown substantially thicker. Wings, ye better show yourself if ye're hiding on me. He warns the magic item. As expected, he feels a pulling sensation as the item diffuses from his body, like pulling off wet scuba gear. The cloak billows out once more, and the phantom twinges cease. It was necessary to avoid detection. The wings inform him. Ye could have mentioned that ye can do that. The dragonborn mentions as he rolls his shoulders and puts his armor back on. It was unintended. I required additional energy and assistance to regenerate after our last battle. You were the nearest source of nourishment, and it also ensured that I was not taken, so it proved to be a benefit. Nourishment? Ye better nee be eating me coat or I'll turn ye into a carpet. No, simply integrating with your body and allow its natural healing processes to repair me. Since I bonded with you I've been working on better integrating myself. This was a natural next step. Ye could have at least asked before ye started integrating, as ye put it. Why do ye even need to mix yourself in with me in the first place? Asterisk to ensure superior functioning. I must adapt to my host and in turn adapt them to me to ensure proper flight. I must draw from your distinct anatomy to alter myself to better suit it and must impart to you how to fly so that we do not crash ourselves into a tree. Asterisk. Fair enough. Anything else ye do that I should be aware of? Asterisk no. My potential is currently limited. However, our captor provides a unique opportunity. Asterisk. What's that? I am composed primarily of red dragon components, although I have also absorbed a substantial portion of your blood and tissue in order to adapt and complete myself. Absorption of more of him would prove potentially useful for enhancing my abilities. Blood in particular would be useful. Ye want to absorb a dragon? Why in the nine hells do ye want that? The cloak is silent for a long moment. Asterisk because I am a failure. Asterisk it answers after a while asterisk a failed attempt at something greater. I am uncertain what I was meant to be, but I am only aware that my creator was unsuccessful. However, they did instill a potential for growth into me. I wish to fulfill that potential. Asterisk. HM. Arna Ken that are working complete could ken it themselves and wish to fix it. I suppose it makes sense though. The gods crafted me an Arcan Grow, What a worship it must have been to forge a work that could itself think and grow. Kaz says, pondering the magical item. Well, ye can talk, ye can think, ye can feel, and ye have been helping me, so I suppose I best return the favor. Ye'll need a name though. A name? I fail to see the purpose of a name. Nonsense, all the famous magical items have names for themselves, whom? Ye want to gain the strength of a dragon, how about Sivrid? After the bloke who turned himself into a dragonborn. Asterisk Sivrid. HM, I approve. Asterisk. Sivrid the incomplete wings concurs. Right then, Siag me mate, let's figure out how to get out of this bloody place. Kazdor examines the door. It's locked from the outside, but not barred. Unfortunately, it's far too heavy to knock down without both hurting himself, and also alerting everyone in the area. He doesn't think he can pick the lock, then he turns to Bluggle. Wah, wee laddie, can ye get inside this thing and pop it open? He asks the water elemental quietly. Bluggle bubbles an affirmative and slips inside the lock. A few moments later, Kaz hears a pop sound. Kazdor pokes his head out of the crack and sees that the prison is set into a pit, with chains running down the sides. Fortunately, he has his wings, and is able to flap out of the pit with no issue. He hovers in the air for a moment, as the entire floor is covered in a grid of chains. There don't appear to be any guards though. Kaz moves very carefully between the tight web of iron towards the only exit, and peeks around the corner. He doesn't see anyone, but sees all the chains lead back that way. He continues until they all knot into a single chain which strings upwards into the ceiling. He avoids touching it. He is now at a crossroads, with three other routes. Two go down, one goes up. Most folk would go up, but Kaz knows that the place is still guarded, and up probably leads to the exit. Better to go deeper, where they won't expect it. Hide away there, then when search parties are sent out, or better yet the dragon and his devils leave to find him themselves, find the hoard, find his weapons, and then make his escape. He takes the left-hand path down into the dark. As Kaz, Siag, and Bluggle try to figure how to get out, the rescue team outdoors is busy trying to figure out how to get in. They draw near to the dragon's lair, moving slowly across the kilometers of scorched earth between them and the mountain, keenly aware of how little cover they have among the skeletons of trees. They observe the mountain carefully, looking for any possibility of an entrance. It is Undri who spots it first, a cave mouth near the base, her keen eyes picking out the dark spot among the white ash. She points it towards the others, but they have their own concerns. They're all looking up towards the peak. Exiting from a second entrance higher up on the mountain top, Avernius the Burning Lord steps out to survey his domain. The party sees him clearly, shining like a ruby in the midday sunlight against the snow-capped peak and the brilliant blue sky. He looks about and breathes in the fresh air deeply, with a great sense of self-satisfaction. Then he spreads his wings, and takes into the sky. Realizing their danger, the party looks around for cover to hide in but finds none, when Senkit gets an idea. Get down. She orders them. On your bellies. The others comply quickly, and Senkit hurries, using the edge of her shield as a shovel to heap the layers of ash on top of them to make them blend in with the floor. Then she drops her shield under the ash to make sure its shine doesn't give them away. She rolls in the ash to cover her armor to make sure of the same, and then lies down face up, tail under her and heaps ash on her scarlet face to make sure it doesn't stand out. The party lies completely still as Avernius passes over, not moving except to track his flight path. He flies over the entirety of his domain, circling all around it several times, a process that takes about an hour. Then he lands near a spot not far from the mountain's base. Undri looks carefully to see what he is doing, and finds that he is taking a long drink from a pond that formed there, likely from snowmelt and runoff. For those of you wondering why there's snow in a land of eternal summer, mountains and the nearness to the border are why. They are near enough to the edges of the land that other seasons do have a mild effect here, including occasional snow. The tops of the mountains are cold enough that the snow that settles there does not melt, save for on particularly hot days. Nobody moves, as the dragon drinks for 10 minutes straight before taking off again and returning to his perch, stepping from there into the shadows of his lair. The party finally stands up, quite stiff, and shakes off the ash as best they are able. That may complicate things. Julian says as he shakes the ash out of his ear and shakes his head. He has begun growing hair again as he hasn't had time to shave in several weeks. His hair is raven black, at least the parts that aren't coated in ashes. Not a very creative sort, is he? Peregrine comments, sounding rather disappointed. I mean burning lore for a red dragon. It seems a bit well done. Senkit and Julian groan at the terrible pun, but Undri just looks confused. Well done is another way of saying overcooked, particularly with beef, Senkit explains. Oh, the pescatarian elf responds. The party continues forwards towards the entrance. At about 1,000 feet out, Undri raises a hand for a halt. She can see ahead and notices two guards, both kobolds, at the gate. She draws her bow and creeps forwards, the others in her wake. There is very little cover in the barren white, which reflects the sun's light in a harsh glare. What thin shadows lie between the skeletal husks of trees that remain is far too faint and thin to give cover. From any perspective, it should be impossible to approach stealthily. Or at least, that's what Avernius thought when he scorched the lands nearest his lair. Surely any guard would be able to see an approaching enemy plainly with as bright as the ash was, even at night. A shame he forgot his guards were kobolds, and they can't see shit in all that light, especially around midday. Well, that's not entirely fair. They can see fairly well, but not at 600 feet. Undri on the other hand can see well enough to put an arrow in each guard's throat, dropping them before they have a chance to shout the alarm. The party moves in quickly, drags the bodies out of sight of the entrance, and slip inside. Once they reach the main cave entrance, they slip inside the crack in the mountain and look around. They stand in a carved hall, clearly the original cavern, but the stone floor and walls and even ceilings have been smoothed out. It's not really a grand entrance hall, more just a slightly wider area before a corridor. The room is unoccupied, but the small cooking pit, weapon racks, and stone carved chairs indicate that this is probably a break room for the guards. Fortunately for the paladins, it looks like the shift just changed. They proceed into the dark, Undri is in front, but refuses to leave the group. Her knuckles are white, her breathing is more rapid, and those with infrared vision can see her heart is unusually warm, a sign of increased activity. Still, she presses on into the underground. For Kaz. She whispers to herself. As they continue onwards, they come to a door. A general inspection reveals no obvious traps, so Senkit opens it, with shield raised. No trap goes off, no alarm sounds, nothing explodes. The party continues onwards, unaware that above their heads, a chain was drawn back when they opened the door, and somewhere close by, a chitin senses it. Kazdor proceeds down into the dark. Fortunately for him, the tunnel, while winding and a squeeze tight, has no further branches. He comes to a door and sees light on the other side of it, coming through the cracks. He stealthily cracks it and pokes an eye through. Inside, he can see what looks like some form of magical laboratory. He can see tall glass bottles filled with a faintly glowing red fluid, all carefully organized. He can see what looks like some kind of glass tubing that tapers to a very sharp point, much like a quill's tip. He also can see a collection of actual quills and some parchment, but not much else. That is when the screaming starts. The pitch of the voice makes it clear that this is a kobold screaming in agony here, but it is definitely someone in agony. There is a faint sizzling noise as well. Kaz has no idea what is going on, but he refuses to stand for it. He hurls open the door, and the chain above it jerks. That makes the chain devil on the other end sit up and take notice. The earlier tug on the front door was to be expected, possibly a kobold sneaking back from guard duty. Someone to send down to the lab for testing later. When the lab went off though, that bears investigation. After all, a marking test was supposed to be taking place right now in preparation for the experiment on the dragon. The dragonborn. Ah. Kazdor storms into the laboratory, surrounded by arcane and alchemical apparatuses he does not understand. Side note, it should really be apparata and not apparatuses. I mean it's octopus octopi cactus cacti, but not apparatus apparatan. English, you make no sense and throw out good potential words in the process. Where was I? Oh yes, surrounded by apparata he does not understand, jars and bottles of faintly glowing red liquid that looks uncomfortably like blood. Scrolls of orange parchment written on with said liquid in the shape of the brands given to the warlocks who attacked him, primitive syringes, and all manner of other mad scientific nonsense. In the back of the room, though, is the source of the screaming, a kobold who has been strapped into a rack with several of the parchments bound to her naked body. Her eyes have rolled back in her head from the pain, and she has bit her own tongue off and started screaming through a mouthful of blood. Even the stalwart paladin blanches at the sight, and Bluggle hides behind his back. Overlooking the proceedings is a tall, lithe figure, with a build very similar to Undri's. He is clad in a midge's robes spattered with blood, with runes inscribed upon them. His white hair is bound back in a ponytail away from his face, which looks extremely young, almost childlike. His eyes are red, his ears are pointed, and his skin is as black as midnight. He's taking notes on a small pad of paper. Kazdor approaches to free the kobold, but the midge raises a hand. Stop. If you intervene now, the consequences could be dire. He warns Kaz, but Kazdor ignores him. The midge doesn't even move, and his babyish face remains expressionless as he watches the dragonborn approach out of the corner of his eye. Desist. You have no idea what you're doing. He orders again, scribbling down further notes. Kazdor ignores him and goes for the kobold, and the midge throws the paper under his nose. Kaz sees the runes for just a moment before they glow, and then explode in his face. The dragonborn goes sprawling back as the midge raises a thin wand towards him. He starts to chant the words to a spell when Bluggle leaps onto his face, covering his nose and mouth and cutting off his hair. His eyes go wide as he struggles to get the water elemental off him. Kaz takes the opportunity and dives for the torture device, reversing the lever and allowing the kobold to sag downwards. He starts ripping off the branding parchments, and the stench of burning flesh fills the air. The kobold falls silent, blood running out of her mouth. The drow finally manages to squeeze out a cantrip as a midge hand appears and rips the offending water elemental off of him. He raises his hand with the wand in it and finishes his spell. Kazdor shouts in rage as lightning leaps from the wand and strikes the tiny water elemental. Bluggle lets out one small high-pitched bubbling shriek, and then goes still, body evaporating back to the elemental plane of water. Kaz watches his tiny friend die, and then turns from the tortured kobold to the midge to the remnants of Bluggle. Kazdor snaps, and his eyes go purple with blood wrath. He rushes down the drow and with a single blow knocks the wand from his hand and breaks his fingers. Another two punches shatter a rib and crush the midge's nose into his face like a wad of putty, roaring soundlessly in fury. Both the party and the chain devil hear the roar and rush towards the sound of intense violence. The chitin arrives first and lashes a chain around Kaz's waist, pulling him off and giving the midge a chance to blast Kaz with lightning. Sivrid intervenes, manifesting himself and using one of his halves to block the lightning. Kazdor steps forwards, dragging the chain devil behind him, and seizes the midge's other hand in a talon, crushing it and breaking every bone in the drow's hand. His other arm lashes out and hits the midge in the eye, tearing it out with a long claw, then seizes him by his long white hair and drives his face into Kaz's knee. The devil tries to hold Kazdor back, but by now the lead elements of the paladins arrive. Andri puts two arrows into his back, and then Senkit drives those arrows in deeper with a shield bash. The devil whirls into a whirling morning star and deeply regrets it. Meanwhile, the midge tries to open a healing potion by clenching it in his forearms and pulling out the cork with his teeth. Kazdor will not let him. He seizes the midge's arms, one in each talon, and bends them backwards, then jerks them further. There are four sickening cracks as he nearly breaks the drow's forearms off. Not that that would have been any less of a brutal death though. As the midge cowers, trying to get away from the blood midge lizard, Kazdor seizes his head, forces it back, and then bites down on the midge's neck. Kazdor rips out the drow's throat with his teeth like a wild beast, then holds the midge up by his hair. Not satisfied with having nearly decapitated the torture with his jaws, Kaz lets out a sound like Godzilla and blasts the drow's face with a full force fire breath. The blinding heat makes the paladins shield their eyes, and when it's stopped, Kazdor is holding nothing but a blackened skull and spine atop a dead body. Fatality.